Hello everyone and welcome back to the sessions on strategic financial management. Friends, in this class of CA Final SFM, we are talking about the concepts of bond valuation, and today what we are going to discuss is this part within bond valuation, that is yield to maturity, YTM of a bond. So if you can recall, in the previous session I have already given you meaning of YTM, but maybe if you haven't attended that class, let me tell you once again. YTM, yield to maturity. It is yield of a bond from the current date up to its maturity. From investor's viewpoint, it is an internal rate of return of the investment, IRR of the investment. So today we are mainly going to learn how to determine this yield to maturity, and the discussion will be followed by another connecting concept, that is yield to call. So what we do generally is, a bond which is currently priced at whatever amount, if an investor is buying this bond today, the investor will be investing that much money today. If the investor is investing that much money today, investor will have to wait until the bond is matured for its redemption to get back the money. So investment is made today and recovery is made at a later date, and meanwhile during this period of waiting, bond will also offer coupon payments, and those coupon payments will be a regular income for the investor. So coupon rate of the bond, suppose it is 8%, so does that mean that bondholder is earning just 8%? Not necessarily, because the price at which the bond is purchased may not match with the face value of the bond. Redeemable amount of the bond could be yet a different amount. Therefore, the rate of return that an investor would earn over the life of the bond, which we generally technically call as internal rate of return, will definitely be little different from the coupon rate offered by bond. Now, there may be exceptional cases. For example, a bond which is issued now at par, that is rupees 1000, and redeemable after 5 years again at par at 1000, and the bond is offering constant coupon payments at the rate of 8%. So investment now is 1000 and recovery on redemption date will also be 1000. So there is no difference in the amount invested by the bondholder today and the amount that would be recovered by the bondholder on maturity. It is 1000 and 1000. During this life of the bond, bond is going to provide constant coupon payments at the rate of 8%, and we know one thing, coupon rate of 8% will be applied on the face value, which is 1000. So face value is 1000, redeemable value is 1000, purchase price of the bond is also 1000, and in such case you can straight away conclude that the internal rate of the bond is 8% per annum. In other words, the yield to maturity of the bond is 8% per annum. You can conclude it straight away. But just imagine, what if the bond is having face value of 1000, but it is currently traded in the market at rupees 980, and maybe it is redeemable after 5 years at a premium of 10%, means the redemption value will be 1100. In that case, bond is offering coupon payment of 8%, but the bondholder is not going to earn 8% now. Bondholders' yield throughout the life of the bond will be little higher than 8%. Why did I say little higher than 8%? The simple reason is because the bond is anyway offering 8% coupon payment, which will be 8% of 1000, that is rupees 80. And the purchase price of the bond is even less than 1000. Suppose in that case, what will happen? The coupon payments are already more than 8% yield on current basis. When you go to the maturity, you find that the bond is redeeming a value which is higher than the initial purchase price of the bond. In such case, the bond is offering something more. That something more will entitle you to understand one thing, that bond is offering a return higher than 8%. But how much is that return? We will learn how to determine, and there the concept of yield to maturity hits the target. So friends, at intermediate level, you have learned concept of IRR, internal rate of return, under the topic capital budgeting. But many of you would not have been able to recall that concept. So what I am trying to do is, I am trying to give you a recap of IRR, but not through capital budgeting, through this topic bond valuation, and that too not in the name of IRR. The name of this subheading we have placed over here is yield to maturity. So what I will do is, I will initially give you some notes on this, please write it down, and then we will start attempting calculation based examples. When we start dealing with calculation based examples, the conceptual understanding, the calculations, everything will be crystal clear. Once we are done with the concept of yield to maturity, we will move to the next concept, the connecting concept, yield to call with respect to callable bonds. And thereafter, finally, once we are done with even that, we will practice out some more calculative examples just to build up the command over this concept. One important thing, this session is generally restricted to 1 hour. As a result, I definitely would want you to note down certain important things, and even you might feel like writing down, but I will not allow you enough time to write. I will instruct that quickly take note of this. What you should do is just pause the video, take note of the whole thing, and then you can again resume the video. So my instructions throughout the video will be, quickly take note of this part, what you are finding on screen or what I am presenting on screen. And what you should do is, you should just pause the video, take note of that, again resume the video. I think I am very clear, and let me not put any more time in giving you instructions like this. So let us just head with the concept of yield to maturity, first notes and then the calculative examples. So let us first write up the meaning of YTM, that is yield to maturity. This is a rate of return which is generated by a bond over a period up to its maturity. If the future cash flows of interest and redemption price are discounted using YTM, that means if the discounting rate is same as YTM, the present value of such cash flows will be equal to its actual market price. So what we can finally conclude, that a rate of discounting which can make the intrinsic value equal to the actual market price can be considered as YTM rate. So friends, I want you to quickly take note of this whole thing. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now let us learn the application of this concept, and for that we take a calculative example which is given in question number 3. Let us read this question. Face value of the bond is given as rupees 1000, redeemable after 4 years at rupees 1200, coupon rate is 8% per annum. Determine the yield to maturity if the present market price of the bond is rupees 1050. So friends, first of all, some basic things let us try to discuss. This is the current market price, and the future cash flows of the bond will be 1000 into 8%, that is rupees 80 every year for the coupon payment. And finally, at end of fourth year, the redemption price is 1200. So what we can observe is that the current market price at which we can buy the bond is 1050, and the redemption price is definitely more than that. That means, apart from giving this coupon payment, the bond is giving you something more, right? Because today if you invest 1050, over and above the coupon payments, the bond is going to give you redemption value of 1200. That means the rate of return of the bond is definitely little more than 8%. So what we do is, we start making trials, and for that we say try it out using 10% discounting rate. So what we do is we simply try to find the intrinsic value using discounting rate of 10%. We just randomly took 10%, and the base idea was the rate that we should consider must be higher than 8% for sure. Now, when you find the present values, what would happen? The intrinsic value would be 1073.19, and the market price of the bond, that is rupees 1050, it is lower than the intrinsic value determined above. So friends, let us do one thing. Let us first write up this whole content what you find on screen, and then I'm going to give you elaborate explanation on the same. So I'm sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now please carefully listen to what I'm saying. Something important. We are talking about determining IRR of the bond or YTM of the bond. Now friends, what happens to compute IRR? What is the root concept? There are future cash flows. We have seen over here, there are future cash flows, and these cash flows should be discounted definitely using some discounting rate. We don't know what should be that discounting rate, but it should be such discounting rate so that the present value should match with the market price of the bond today, because the market price is what we have to pay today from our pocket to buy the bond. So that means today the cost of the bond will be its market price. So whatever be the market price, the present value of future cash flows should match with this. And therefore our objective over here is to match that intrinsic value. Intrinsic value is just another name given for the present value, you know it. So we have to match that intrinsic value with the quoted market price. So what we find, that quoted market price is 1050, which is lower, and the intrinsic value that we have obtained over here is 1073.19. So intrinsic value is more and the quoted market price is less. Quoted market price is a fact which cannot be altered, because that is the fact, it is prevailing in the market. What is in our hands to change the discounting rate and accordingly change the intrinsic value? Now, how does intrinsic value change with the discounting rate? We have learned these concepts also earlier. If you can recall, the present value calculation is always inversely related to the discounting rate. So if you increase the discounting rate, the present value will fall. If you reduce the discounting rate, the present value would rise. This is a fundamental fact. For your purpose, I would repeat that same thing once again. Present value is always inversely related to the discounting rate. If you increase the discounting rate, the present value will decline, the present value will fall. What we have to do in this scenario, just assess. Present value what we obtained is 1073.19, and the cost of the bond, that is the market price of the bond, is 1050. So we have to bring the present value down to 1050. So it is obvious that the discounting rate that we now apply should be a higher rate. So we will make another trial by 11%, a little higher rate. If by 11% the present value what we get is still found to be more than 1050, we will again try with a next higher rate. Now, trial and error method is the only method which will give you accurate results. What we will do is, through trial and error, we will fix a range of discounting rate, a lower discounting rate and a higher discounting rate, and the internal rate of return of the bond or YTM or yield to maturity of the bond will be between these two rates. So friends, we need to figure out a rate which is used as discounting rate, and that will result into the present value being lower than 1050. Then we can consider that between these two rates the YTM would lie. So it is obvious that our next trial from here will be at a rate which is higher than 10%. So we are going to make the next trial with 11%. What has to be done next? You can easily understand once we arrive at those calculations. So if suppose we are successfully, you know, getting the present value lower than 1050 at 11% rate, we can easily conclude that between 10% and 11%, the bond has its yield to maturity. What we will then do is, we will then consider 10% as a lower discounting rate and 11% as a higher discounting rate, and we will use mathematical interpolation to arrive at the YTM rate between these two rates. And that interpolation I will first explain you logically, and then we will also learn it through a formula base. But everything will come at its time one by one. So let us first make another trial with that 11% discounting rate. Now, what is your objective? Your objective is to bring down this intrinsic value matching with this market price. That means you want to reduce this value. If you want to reduce this value, you should increase the discounting rate. That means right now the trial was made at 10%. Now you increase the discounting rate maybe to 11%. If you do that, this value will definitely come down. And if it is lower than 1050, we get what we want. So let us see how to present the later part of the solution. What we do now is we take up 11% as discounting rate. We do exactly the same thing what we have done earlier with 10% discounting rate. Obviously, the PV factors and the resulting present value calculations will change now. And what we find now, the intrinsic value is definitely 1038.68, which is lower than market price. In other words, the market price is higher than this intrinsic value. So we can say that the market price of the bond, that is 1050, is higher than the intrinsic value determined above. Yet another concluding line we have to write. Therefore, YTM of the bond must be between 10% and 11%. So write this whole thing quickly and then we move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now something most important. We are going to apply interpolation technique for determining YTM. And let me explain you how to do this logically first. So what we do is, we first identify a range between 10% and 11%, and we note down the respective intrinsic values what we got at 10% and what we got at 11%. So the range is between 10 and 11%. The gap between 10% and 11% is 1%. Now we know one thing for sure, that the YTM of the bond is within this range for sure, correct? We also find the difference between the respective present values, and the difference between the respective intrinsic values is found to be 34.51. So the rate that we want to find is between 10 and 11%, means it is 10% plus something. Okay, so how much is 10% plus something? That something we don't know, because if you try to increase the discounting rate by 1%, what is happening? The present value is declining by 34.51. Let me once again repeat this. The rate of return, that is YTM, is lying between 10 and 11%. At 10%, the intrinsic value was 1073.19. You wanted to reduce this to 1050. So you increase the discounting rate by 1%. The present value declined by 34.51, resulting into this present value, which went lower than what we wanted. We wanted 1050. So what was the expected decline? Expected decline was only 23.19, whereas the actual decline came to 34.51. Finally, what we would say is, we would want to increase the discounting rate in such a way that the present value falls by 23.19. Therefore, YTM of the bond is between 10 and 11%, means in other words, it is something more than 10%. So with 1% gap, the present value difference is 34.51. So what should be the gap which will give you difference in present value as 23.19? So simple logic is, by 1% difference, the difference in present value is 34.51. So at what percentage difference, the difference in present value will be 23.19? So let us find out the value of this question mark. So that will be by cross multiplication, 23.19 multiplied by 1 divided by 34.51. So what we have done, 23.19 into 1 divided by 34.51, and that is giving you 0.672. So YTM will be 10% plus this question mark. Question mark value is 0.672. So YTM finally comes to 10 plus 0.672. So YTM is 10.672% approx. Friends, in examination, if you don't want to write up this logic, there is another way in which you can use an interpolation formula. I'll show you that in a while, but first do one thing. First write this whole thing carefully with complete understanding of the concept. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this as well. Let us move ahead and now use interpolation formula for determining YTM. It is the same thing that we are trying to do, but now using a kind of formula. So let me explain this formula. YTM will be LDR. LDR stands for lower discounting rate. In the range of the discounting rates between 10 and 11%, we will consider 10% as lower discounting rate and 11% as higher discounting rate. This numerator is IV at LDR. IV stands for intrinsic value. Intrinsic value at lower discounting rate minus market price divided by intrinsic value at lower discounting rate minus intrinsic value at higher discounting rate multiplied by difference between HDR and LDR, that is higher discounting rate minus lower discounting rate. So when you apply the values, LDR, lower discounting rate, was 10. Intrinsic value at lower discounting rate was 1073.19. Market price was 1050. Intrinsic value at higher discounting rate was 1038.68 into HDR minus LDR, that is 11 minus 10. When you apply this calculation, you would see the application of same logic what we have discussed earlier. So recall, this difference is 23.19, which we wanted. This difference was the difference that was obtained between 10 and 11% present values. This one was the difference between 11 and 10. And this whole thing was the value of the question mark, which was to be added to 10 to arrive at YTM of 10.672%. So friends, I am giving you time. Note down this as well. In examination, you may follow any one approach, whichever approach you prefer. As far as ICAI is concerned, it will accept any of them. So quickly write up this and then we move ahead. Alright friends, I'm sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. There is yet another way in which you can solve this. Though that is not a preferred approach, it is an approximation formula for determining YTM. So what happens? You could see one thing. This is the cost of debt formula what you have used generally at your inter level for determining cost of debt. Let us first try to understand this formula. This C is the coupon payment, which will be your annual income, which in our example is rupees 80, and R is the redemption price and P is the current market price. Difference between redemption price and current market price is the extra earning that you are getting, but that will be spread over the life of the bond, which is 4 years in our case. And in the denominator, you would take the simple average of the redemption price and the current market price. So let us define all these variables and put up these values. This is not a preferred technique, but this is found to be used by ICAI in earlier examination suggested answers. So let us apply these calculations and we obtain YTM as 10.44%. So again, I'm telling you, this is not the preferred approach, but this can be used in examination because ICAI would accept this also. So quickly take note of this and then we move ahead. So friends, I'm sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. As we discussed that after completing the discussion on yield to maturity, we will talk about the connecting concept, that is yield to call. So please write up this next heading in your notebooks, yield to call. Now, what is yield to call? First of all, you will have to recall the concept of callable bonds. Imagine a situation that I am a bond issuing company. I have issued a bond with a life of 10 years, but I have a right to call back these bonds at end of 5th year from the date of issue, and I will be completely taking that call at my choice. If I want, I will call back this bond and redeem that even at end of 5th year. However, if I don't want to exercise that call option, I will just let it be as it is, and finally I'll redeem the bonds at 10th year end. So such bonds, first of all, are considered as callable bonds. These are bonds attached with a call option, and that call option is in the hands of the issuing company. So think yourself, imagine yourself as an investor of such bond. You have no choice to make, so you are uncertain. Anything can happen. By the time the 5 years of life of bond is over, company may make a call and ask for the redemption of the bond, that is surrender of the bond for the redemption purpose. Or if the company wants, it can continue. That means if you are an investor and you want to find out your yield, first of all, you should be clear that you have to find yield from the beginning period to which date, to the call date or to the maturity date. Now, nothing is in your hand, so you would generally compute both the yields. So you would compute yield to call as well as yield to maturity. Yield to call will be from the purchase date up to the date of call. So it is IRR of the bond, but from the date of purchase to the date of call. And the yield to maturity is also IRR of bond. It is IRR from the date of purchase till the maturity of the bond. So the manner in which we have learnt how to determine yield to maturity, it is exactly same way we will learn how to determine yield to call. So it is same concept, just the time period will be different. And friends, I have very good questions at the later part of this class, which are mixed questions from yield to maturity and yield to call. Good tricky questions. If these questions are answered well, you are just going to be amazed, because in situations where students have lack of clarity with respect to those type of calculations, those type of tricky calculations, students may get stuck in examination or commit errors. So let us again move step by step. First, let me provide you some notes on yield to call, and then we will start with those questions which are practice questions for you. We will be applying same concept but with a little tricky situations. So let us move ahead with the same. As I have already explained, this is just like yield to maturity, but it is not the yield up to maturity. It is yield up to call date only, and obviously it is applicable for callable bonds only. So YTC is applicable only for callable bonds. YTC is determined just like YTM. The applicable date of redemption will be the call date and not the maturity date. The redemption value will be the call price. So take note of these quickly and then we shall move ahead. Now let us do one thing. Let us practice some questions based on yield to maturity and yield to call, that is YTM and YTC. So let us begin with question number 12. Let us read this question. Face value of the bond is given as rupees 1000. issue price of the bond is ₹980, coupon rate is 9% per annum. These bonds are redeemable after 10 years at ₹1050. The bond is callable bond and the company can call for redemption at end of 5th year at its option at ₹1120. You are required to determine YTC and YTM. YTC stands for yield to call and YTM stands for yield to maturity. So basically, both of these calculations, YTC and YTM, they represent internal rate of return or IRR for the bond holder. Only difference is this will be from present date up to the call date. That means the yield up to call. That is why it is called yield to call. And YTM stands for yield to maturity. That means the yield if the bond is held till maturity. Now, because the bonds are callable bonds, what will happen? You will have to figure out what is the yield if the bond is existing only up to the call date and what is going to be the yield if the bond exists till maturity. So, calculation will be done in the same way and we have learned how to calculate YTM of any bond. So, let us just see how to present the solution. So, we are first attempting to determine the yield to call based on the call date. So, for that obviously we will have to figure out the intrinsic value at lower and higher discounting rates. We are starting our trial with 11% per annum. So, what we now do is we would take years 1 to 5 because the call date will be after 5 years from the date of issue. So, based on cash flows of 5 years, the discounting factors or PV factors also have been figured out for 5 years. And finally, when you apply these factors, you get present value of cash flows. So, what we get? Intrinsic value based on the call date, that is intrinsic value considering only 5 years of bond's call date from the date of issue, the intrinsic value has finally come to 997.35. However, the issue price of the bond is not 997.35, correct? Issue price of the bond is 980 and it is lower than the intrinsic value determined above. So, what would happen? Your objective is to bring down this value matching with this. So, if you need to reduce this value in the next trial, you will have to increase the discounting rate, correct? So, before we do that, first do one thing, write up this whole part of solution and then we shall definitely move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now what we do is, we have already discussed that we need to bring this present value matching with the issue price of 980. So if you want to bring down the present value, you need to increase the discounting rate because present value is always inversely related to the discounting rate. So if you want to bring down this present value, we are now going to make a trial by a higher rate, maybe by 12% per annum. So we are still sticking to the call date, which is after 5 years from the date of issue. So same thing done, but now the discounting rate what we have considered is 12% per annum. We get the present values of cash flows totaling to 959.92, and now we see that this is lower than 980. In other words, 980 is higher than the intrinsic value determined above. So one thing is for sure, at 11% we got something more than 980 and at 12% we got something less than 980. So the YTC of the bond, the yield to call for the bond will be definitely between 11% and 12%. So we will calculate that using interpolation. But first what you do is note down this whole thing and then we shall move ahead. Alright friends, I am sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now we know that the yield to call of the bond is lying between the two rates, that is 11% and 12%. we use interpolation for determining YTC. Whatever you are finding on screen, I am not going to explain that again. We have learned this whole concept earlier. Now, I would simply say it is intrinsic value at lower discounting rate minus market price. Now, because here the market price is simply given as 980 as issue price. Remember that this is the fresh bond which is being issued. So the market price over here, what you are considering is nothing but the primary market price. That means it will be the issue price of 980. So it is 997.35 minus 980, and in the denominator it will be 997.35 minus 959.92. The gap between the two rates of discounting was 12 and 11. So 12 minus 11, that is 1% is the gap. So finally, the YTC calculation would end up to 11.46% approx. So do one thing, write up the whole calculation, and that will be the YTC calculation. Once we are done with this, we shall move ahead and also determine YTM. Alright friends, I'm sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now one very very important point. You can see one thing, that the call price in this case was higher than the maturity price or the redemption price. So it is obvious that the yield to call was higher, but yield to maturity will not be this rate, it will be a lower rate. So when we have to find the yield to maturity, we will be making a trial at a lower rate. So we have used 10% as the discounting rate. Let us see what happens when you are using 10% discounting rate. The present value comes to 957.79. Now the issue price of the bond is 980. So we find that the present value, even at taking a discounting rate as low as 10%, it is still lower than the issue price. In other words, the issue price is higher than that. So what you will have to do in order to increase this present value, the next trial that you should make will be at a rate lower than 9%. But before we do that, first write down what you find on the screen. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. As we have discussed, we will now make the next trial by taking a lower discounting rate. Let us try it out at 9% per annum. So what we do now is, we make the same present value calculation. Two things that you should observe: because we are computing yield to maturity, we are taking 10 years time, correct? So the intrinsic value this time is coming up to 1021.11, whereas the issue price is lower than the intrinsic value determined above. So one thing is very sure, that the YTM of the bond must be between 9% and 10%. So note down this whole thing, and then we apply interpolation and determine YTM. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing as well. Let us move ahead and use interpolation for determining YTM. And it is the same interpolation formula. And what we just do is put up the values that we have obtained in the earlier workings. This time higher discounting rate is 10% and lower discounting rate is 9%, and the present values have been considered accordingly. So YTM of the bond will be between 9 and 10%, which comes to 9.649% approx. So note down this as well, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Let us move ahead and take up the next question, that is question number 13. Let us read this question. Face value of the bond is given as rupees 1000, coupon rate is 8%. The bond is issued at par and redeemable at 10% premium on maturity, that is 10 years from the date of issue. The bonds are callable at end of fourth year from the date of issue. You are required to determine the redemption amount on the call date if YTC is 150 basis points higher than YTM. So friends, notice one thing, what is happening here? YTC is given as 150 basis points higher than YTM. That means the calculation of YTC is dependent upon YTM, first of all. So obvious thing is, first you will have to determine YTM. Now, the bond is redeemable at 10% premium on maturity, that is after 10 years. Face value of the bond is 1000 and the bond is issued at par, that means the issue price of the bond is also rupees 1000. And the redemption amount will be 10% premium, that is 1100. So obviously the bond is providing an yield which is higher than 8% for sure. So what we will first do is, we will work out the YTM, and based on YTM we will work out YTC. Once you know what is YTC, we will be able to compute the call price, that is the redemption amount at the call date. So friends, as we have discussed, first we will have to work out the YTM in this question. So let us see how to present the solution. In the solution, we are making trial by 9%. Why? Because I explained you already that the bond is capable of generating a return little more than 9%. So what we finally do is, we make a present value calculation for all 10 years of cash flows based on 9% discounting rate, and what we finally get, intrinsic value as 978.06. On the other side, the issue price of the bond, it is 1000, which is higher than the intrinsic value determined above. So what you will have to do, you will have to increase this value to match with 1000. To increase the present value, you need to reduce the discounting rate, correct? Because the present value is inversely related to the discounting rate. However, before we make another trial by a lower rate to get a higher present value, first write down what you find on screen. Alright friends, I'm sure you have finished writing this whole thing. Now let us make once again the calculation of intrinsic value or the present value using a lower discounting rate, say 8%. So we are now making again the present value calculation using 8% discounting rate. So everything remains same, the PV factors will obviously change, and accordingly the present value of cash flows would also change. So the intrinsic value what we now get is 1046.33, and the issue price of the bond, that is 1000, is lower than the intrinsic value determined above. That means it is assured that the YTM of the bond must be between 8% and 9%. So note down this part of the solution as well, and then we shall move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this also. Now let us do one thing, let us use interpolation and determine the YTM that would lie between 8% and 9%. So you know how to do it, I am just guiding you. So you would once again consider the fact that the market price over here will be the primary market price or the issue price, because the bond is directly being purchased at the time of issue itself. So the market price will be the issue price, which is at par. Therefore, this market price will be taken as rupees 1000, and other intrinsic value calculations we already have in hand. So when you apply this calculation, what you get is something more than 8%, and that works out to 8.68% as YTM. Now YTC is reported as 150 basis points higher than YTM. That means it will be on absolute basis 1.5% added to 8.68%, and finally what you get is 10.18% as YTC. So we could get YTM as well as YTC. So friends, प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड एवरीथिंग एंड नोट डाउन ऑल दीज कैलकुलेशंस केयरफुली एंड देन वी शैल मूव अहेड. All right, friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now let us move ahead. After knowing the yield to call or YTC, we are now ready to determine the call price or the redemption price that will be applicable at the call date. If you can notice one thing, such information was not given to you. In fact, the question has demanded that calculation from you. So let us see how to work it out. It is very simple. We would say let the call price be X. So when you plot the present value calculation, you are using YTC of 10.18%, and in place of the call price we have kept X, and the time duration that we have considered over here is just 4 years, because the bond is callable after 4 years. So when you make the present value calculation, notice one thing: what happens in the second line, the PV factor is 0.6786 and the cash flow is assumed to be X. So the cash flow present value will be 0.6786X. And when you find that present value, this whole thing must match with 1000, right? So 1000 minus 252.60 would give you 0.6786X. So you can work out the value of 0.6786X will be 747.40. Let me explain this once again. This whole thing is the present value, right? And that present value has to match with the issue price, because 10.18% is yield to call. Yield to call will be IRR of the bond up to the call date, and the cash flows are these, and the present value, whatever you get, has to match with the primary market price or the issue price of rupees 1000. So when you set up this equation, you can find the value of 0.6786X by shifting 252.60 to the left hand side, and that would give you 1000 minus 252.60, which is 747.40. Finally, the value of X is 1101.39. So you can say the call price rounded off to rupees 1101. So friends, note down this whole thing, and that will be end of the solution. All right, friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Let us move ahead and take up the next question, that is question number 14. A bond has remaining maturity of 4 years and coupon payments are rupees 90 per annum at year end, and redemption amount is 1150. The bond is callable after 1 year from now and redemption amount is 1200. You are required to determine YTC if YTM is 10% per annum. So friends, in this question, the YTM is already given to you. You can apply that YTM and determine the present value. We have learned one thing: if YTM is considered as discounting rate, the resulting present value will match with the market price, correct? So let us first figure out what will be the market price. So when YTM is used as discounting rate, the present value of cash flow will be equal to market price. So we have applied the present value calculation for 4 years of cash flows at 10% discounting rate, which results into the present value of 1070.74, which is identified as market price of the bond. So we can conclude that the current market price of the bond is 1070.74. Now the bond is callable just after 1 year from this date, right? So if the bond is called back after 1 year, what will be the call price? The call price will be 1200 and there will be a coupon payment of rupees 90. That means finally, if the bond is called back after 1 year, the overall cash flows after 1 year will be 1290. From now and this date, there is a gap of only 1 year. So the YTC can directly be determined, correct? Using a simple straightforward logic, that is to say that the current value of the bond in the market, the current market price is 1070.74, and after 1 year, if the bond is called back, its value will be 1290. The gap between these two just being 1 year, we could simply find this difference. You know, the way we take P1 minus P0 divided by P0, exactly same approach. This is the value after 1 year. This is the investment required now. So you can easily find out the rate of return for 1 year by taking YTC equals to 1290 minus 1070.74 divided by 1070.74. And finally, what you get is 20.48%. So please take note of this whole thing, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing these calculations also. Let us move ahead and take up the next question. That will be question number 35. Face value of the bond is rupees 1000. Market price of the bond is rupees 986. The bond is redeemable after 5 years at 15% premium. Coupon rate is 8% per annum. Coupon payments are made at end of the each year, and you are required to determine YTM, that is yield to maturity, for this bond. So determining yield to maturity, we have learned already earlier how to do this. So friends, what you should understand is the bond has face value of 1000 and it is redeemable after 5 years at 15% premium. That means the redemption price is going to be 1150, correct? 15% premium, 1150. Then the bond has coupon rate of just 8%, but it is obvious that because the bond is redeemable at premium and currently the bond has market price even below its face value, obviously the yield of the bond is going to be quite more than 8% per annum. So let us see how to determine the yield to maturity as required in the given case. And for that, we will make trials, correct? We have learned that we will have to make trials and determine intrinsic value and try to match the intrinsic value with the market price of the bond. The rate at which the intrinsic value would match with the market price of the bond, in other words, the rate or discounting rate which will let the market price match with the present value of the cash flows, that rate will be the YTM rate or yield to maturity rate. So let us see how to present the solution. In the solution, what we do is we first begin with a trial by say 10% discounting rate, and what we do is the cash flows of year 1 to 5 as rupees 80 representing the coupon payment, and 5th year cash flow will be the redemption value, that is 1150. We find the PV factors at 10% discounting rate for these 5 years of cash flows, and when we multiply these PV factors to the respective cash flows, we get the present value of cash flows, and the intrinsic value comes to 1017.32. Now the market price of the bond is lower than this, right? So the market price of the bond is rupees 986, which is lower than the intrinsic value determined above. So what you will have to do in the next trial, your objective should be to bring down this intrinsic value to match with the market price. That means to bring down the present value of future cash flow, the discounting rate has to be increased because present value is inversely related to the discounting rate. So friends, before we do all that calculation ahead, note down all these calculations and then we move further. Alright friends, you would have finished writing all these present value calculations, and where we have taken the discounting rate as 10% per annum, and I have just explained you some time back that because the intrinsic value is more and the market price is less, what you will have to do is now make another trial with a little higher rate. So let us do that. We now make a trial at 11% per annum. So we plot the same calculations, but now taking the discounting rate as 11% per annum, and look into what happens to the present value of cash flows. This time the intrinsic value that represents the present value of cash flow, it has been 978.14. Now this is definitely lower than the market price, or we would say that the market price is higher than this value. So the market price of the bond, that is rupees 986, is higher than the intrinsic value that we have determined above, and we can therefore conclude that the YTM of the bond, yield to maturity of the bond, must be between 10% and 11%. So friends, do one thing, before we move ahead, write up all these calculations and then we shall determine the yield to maturity. Alright friends, you would have finished writing these calculations. So let us do one thing, let us interpolate the values. That means we will use statistical interpolation to determine the yield to maturity, which we have concluded that it must be between 10% and 11%. So let us see how to do that. Using interpolation formula for determining YTM, we have already learned application of this formula earlier. I have explained you the logic behind this whole formula earlier, correct? In the earlier questions, if you would want to refer, it was question number 3 where we have learned the logic behind this formula. So YTM stands for yield to maturity, LDR is the lower discounting rate, HDR is the higher discounting rate, IV stands for intrinsic value, and MP stands for the market price. So what we find now, YTM is between 10 and 11%, so 10% is declared as the lower discounting rate and 11% is declared as a higher discounting rate. Now IV at LDR, intrinsic value at lower discounting rate, will be 1017.32, IV at HDR was 978.14, and the market price of the bond, which we have to place over here in the numerator, is 986. When you make up these calculations, it will be 10 plus 31.32 divided by 39.18, and this fraction multiplied by 1. Finally, what you get is YTM equals to 10.80 approx. So we have learned one thing, that there is no way that you can compute the accurate YTM even by using interpolation, which is the best technique by far available with us. We will not be getting the accurate calculation. So whatever YTM value we get, we always should consider that as an approximate value. So please take note of these calculations, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, I am sure you would have finished writing this whole thing. So that was the end of the session. What we have learnt today in this session is everything about yield to maturity and yield to call. All the connecting concepts with lot of practice questions. So friends, we have a continued series of interrelated topics yet to come. Sensitivity of bond, volatility of bond, duration of bond, bond portfolio, immunization of bond, convertible bonds, all those concepts coming up. So making sure that you don't miss out any concept, stay tuned to this channel, stay tuned to my lectures, and if at all you also need to any particular topic on which you want me to put up a video over here, you can just place that request in the comment section. And I request you once again, subscribe to this channel and share these videos, like these videos, and definitely we will be having a long journey ahead over here. So thank you so much for attending this class. I am putting an end to this session, that is end of part 2.